Well, it's great to welcome you to worship once again. It's Friday, it's really sunny. I don't know what it will be like on Sunday, but it's good just to be able to grab some last sunshine, perhaps as we start to see temperatures drop. Who knows? I'm going to try and cut the grass maybe the last time this year, hope so, but I doubt it. We're going to go into worship and share together in the coming weeks. This week we're going to be blessed with the ministry of Majors Gregory and Priya Morgan, our divisional leaders. We're very much looking forward to that. The following week, I've mentioned before, would have been the Territorial Congress, the Congress that was going to be held in Cardiff. Not happening now, of course, but will happen virtually. So our worship next week, our virtual worship, will be online with the Congress. There's some services on Saturday and another meeting on Sunday morning at 9 o'clock. You can watch that live streamed, or you can pick it up after the live stream and watch it at your leisure. The following weekend, Major Linda Cordner is going to lead us in worship. Can you believe that will be November? Now, I know what you're thinking, all this talk of worship, what does that mean? Well, it means that we have met and discussed, and the leadership team have made the collective decision that we will look to return to worship as soon as we practically can. So our risk assessments, the main risk assessment for the use of the building, that was one piece of work, has been accepted. So that's really good to know. And now every activity, worship being one of those activities, needs its own risk assessment and everything thought through. Friends, read the detail in the newsletter. Understand, please, that it isn't worship as we knew it, or as we know it, as we would like it, as we prefer it. It's going to be worship with the constraints of face masks, of not being able to sing, of the band not playing. It will be worship where we can come together, but we can't gather in small groups. We have to be escorted to a seat. We have to do all the things that's required of us. Nothing like ideal, but we know for some of you, it's important that you can have the opportunity to be able to do that. We know for some of you as well that that's not right for you. You're not ready to do that. And we understand and respect that. We'll continue with our virtual worship at the same time. Let's carry on virtually. Let's Zoom and have a cup of coffee on Sunday at 12 noon. Let's Zoom on Tuesday evening. The song says 7:30. Enjoying the fellowship and the worship together online there. Let's look at a quiz on Friday night. Who's going to win tonight? It's Friday today when I'm recording this. We don't know. Stephen and Rian again are our hosts for this week. Let's just calm ourselves. Let's just prepare ourselves as we welcome Majors Gregory and Priya Morgan leading our worship today.
Good morning. Welcome to another week of online worship with the Salvation Army, Southampton Sholing. I'm Priya Morgan, and together with my husband Gregory, we are the divisional leaders of the Salvation Army's Southern Division in the United Kingdom. How are you going today? How are you going as you find yourself in the middle of what is now the 8th month of the COVID pandemic? And it's affecting just about every aspect of our lives, isn't it? Or maybe I'm the only one who seems to be counting the months. I don't know about you, but I'm really struggling at the moment to keep up with some of the rules and the regulations. Now, I don't want you to get me wrong. Some of the rules, they've become second nature to me. I take a face mask with me whenever I step out my front door. I carry hand sanitizer wherever I go. And I'm very conscious trying to stay true to the 2 meters apart rule. But I do have to admit that I am struggling at times to keep up with all the rules and the stipulations when it comes to who I can and who I can't catch up with. How many people can I have in my house? And how many people can I have for a meal? There were a group of religious people back in the day who loved their rules and their regulations, their religious laws and practices. And when Jesus was walking this earth, he was often confronted by the Jewish Pharisees and the Sadducees, who thought they were right in challenging the behaviour of Jesus' followers. You see, these religious legalists, they had a rule for just about everything under the sun, and they did not like it one little bit when they saw Jesus challenging the religious rules and the laws that they spent their entire life trying to get right. Well, today we're looking at what many know as the greatest commandment. And this refers to a time when an expert in religious law confronted Jesus with a question, trying to get him to identify the most important God commandment. And Jesus' answer blew everything out of the water when he started to talk about love. Love for God and love for others. Yes, obeying the law is important. Abiding by rules are important, particularly if we are to keep ourselves and others safe. But let's remember that all these things need to be done within the context of love. And so as we engage in this time of worship today, it's my prayer that you will do so knowing that God loves you and his deepest desire is for you to experience his love over you and around you, bubbling up within you and flowing out of you, so that everyone who knows you will also know the love of God. Share a prayer that I pray for you today. And as I pray this prayer, you may want to simply close your eyes, take a deep breath and breathe it out. And in the quietness and the stillness of this moment, you may want to listen and pray this prayer for yourself, which has been inspired by Ephesians chapter 3. Love. God's love. The love of God that we can all experience. Help me, God, to experience the amazing, astonishing, all-consuming love of Christ. A love that can be experienced in countless dimensions. As I center myself in you, may I know the deeply intimate, far-reaching love of God the enduring, inclusive, and unconditional love of God. God's love, which is endless and goes beyond any measure. May I welcome and accept the love of God, a love that transcends the understanding of my finite mind. For your love, God, is an extravagant love, a love that you pour out into my life. May I live the love of God until I am filled to the brim with this love, overflowing in all the fullness of God. Amen.
What do you think when you hear the word gospel? Do you imagine a monk praying or a saint walking around with a halo over his head? Or do you imagine that family who live in your street who never smoke, drink or swear and how annoying it is when their lawn is always perfect and their children look like tiny angels who floated down from the golden streets on high? Well, it actually doesn't mean any of that. We looked it up. The word gospel just means good news. It's not a religious concept reserved for holy people. It's just fantastic news. absolutely everyone, no exceptions. Good news for broken people and those who have been abused by life, that no one is beyond repair. Good news for the outcasts and the ones who don't fit in, that there are no outsiders to the love of God. Good news for the ones who are burned out on church and hurt by religion, that Jesus is a person in love with you, not an institution that makes mistakes. Good news for the ones who find prayer boring, the Bible difficult, and just aren't very spiritual, because grace is much bigger than that. Good news for those who have everything they want but still feel empty, because satisfaction and joy doesn't come from cash or a nice house or a big fancy car. It comes from knowing why you were made and the one who made you. So, now for the awkward question. If we have such unbelievably good news for absolutely everyone, how come people aren't lining up to hear it? How come people roll their eyes and keep walking when they hear street preachers yelling it at the top of their lungs? How come the local gospel mission isn't bursting at the seams like the Apple Store at Christmas time? I think we're maybe telling it wrong. You see, Christians aren't perfect. I'm sure you figured that out by now. As a wise man once told us, if a Christian gets disconnected from Christ, you're just left with Ian. And this guy, Ian, can be a real nasty chap. He's proud, mean, and more interested in the rules than people. Ian makes it sound like the gospel is only good news for people who are just like him and don't challenge any of his assumptions. Ian used the gospel to put himself on a pedestal so he can point out other people's flaws from up there and feel better about himself. At his worst, Ian tried to twist the promises of the gospel to prey on the vulnerable and to take their hard-earned money. And Ian even had the audacity to turn the gospel into campaign slogans and political propaganda to gain power for himself. We need to wrestle the gospel back off Ian and make it sound like good news again. Because if it doesn't sound like good news, it isn't the gospel and it isn't Jesus. You see, if religion doesn't lead you to Jesus, then it's a train you don't ever want to get on. It's just not enough on its own. We need to reclaim some of the amazing things that Ian has hijacked and make them gospel again. Things like the word evangelical. Now, don't be scared. This word is not political ammunition. It's not a pre-warning of an impending sales pitch. It just means carrier of good news. Isn't that beautiful? We don't have to peddle a religious product or bang the drum of any political party. We just carry good news without agenda. You see, here's the human problem. We are all aching for real, meaningful, joyful life. But let's be honest, none of us have found it on our own. Life is not some philosophical idea that's always out of reach. It's a person, and he is reaching out to us.
You may have heard the saying that the world will never understand the good news until they understand the bad news. But in a world so filled with bad news, fake news, tragic news, I just don't know if that's true anymore. I don't know if they can hear it. It's not that we don't believe in the problem of sin and the brokenness of humanity, but friends, we have a way better story to tell. We have a cross, we have a resurrection, we have a coming king, we have a rescuer and a savior who can put all things right.
We are telling the story that Jesus is and always will be the real good news. That idea might be too simple for some or too naive for others, but that's the amazing truth. That's the gospel for absolutely everyone, including Ian.
Yay!
And that's good news worth sharing.
Good morning. The Bible reading for this morning has been chosen from Matthew chapter 24, verses 34 to 40, and I'm reading from the New International Version, and it's entitled The Greatest Commandment. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question: "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbour as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Amen.
Thank you. Is a glass half full or is it half empty? When you have to put on a face mask, is it there to protect others and yourself so you'll wear it properly? Or is it an inconvenience just to annoy you so you'll have your nose hanging out or you'll have it half hanging off of your chin? What is your natural focus? Do you like to focus on the positives, the fullness, or do you have a half empty approach to life and see all of the problems? Growing up in the Salvation Army at times, holiness seemed to be more defined by all the things we didn't do rather than anything else. Don't drink, don't smoke, don't go to wild parties, don't get caught up in fashion and trends, and don't hang out with girls who do any of the above. Holiness seemed to be all about prohibition, about following rules, about not doing things. A glass, half-empty perspective on living a life of faith. A perspective that says the world is evil, the devil is out to get me, and I have to work hard at not doing things so that I can be holy and earn favour with God. And was I holy? Well, if it depended on that list of things not to do, then I failed. I think I understand the rules, I understand the motivation even, but when our Christianity, when our holiness is all about a rules-based religion, I think that we've missed the point. We've adopted a glass, half-empty Christianity. Sorry to turn things around, but I think it's important for us to think about holiness in a different way. Do we live a rules-based religion, or is following Jesus about fullness of life? Rules or fullness? Why can't our holiness be defined by the richness of who we are and what we pursue rather than all the things we have to avoid? Holiness is about fullness. We heard earlier from Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 to 40. And these verses come at the end of a series of passages where Jesus and the good religious people, the Pharisees and Sadducees of his day, have been having a heated discussion over a few issues. Now, the Pharisees and Sadducees, they knew their religion well. They knew their holy scriptures intimately and had everything tied down. There was a religious rule to preserve their holiness in just about any situation. A lot like those of us perhaps who've spent most of our lives in the church. And they try to test Jesus, test him with a question about what part of the law is the greatest. And look at Jesus' reply in verses 37 to 40. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbour as yourself. All of the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. So many juicy laws that Jesus could have chosen. Complicated procedures, limiting laws, purifying performances. So many that Jesus could have chosen. And what does he say? Love God, love your neighbour. Everything else hangs on that. Jesus takes a question about legalism and turns it into an issue of love and fullness of life. And we need to take Jesus' words on board as we think through the issues of how we live a holy life as his followers today. Holiness is not about rules and compliance, but rather it is about a fervent love for God and for others. And that may be a shift in thinking for some of us, particularly if we thought that holiness was just about me and God and nothing else. We've got a bigger picture here. Holiness means loving God with all our heart and also means loving others fervently as well. Now, before I go on, let's note that in verse 40, Jesus says, all of the law and prophets hang on these two things. So Jesus doesn't say throw everything else out, but he reframes them as actions of love and fullness. And that helps us understand that the choices that we make as salvationists, perhaps to abstain from certain practices, are acts of love. I don't smoke or drink as part of my relationship with God to enhance my life, to enhance my health, to enhance the health of others. It's not about rules, but fullness. And our passage from Matthew gives us two key points if we want to desire holiness today. First, verse 37, love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. Now, these words were very familiar to the Jews. It was a quote from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, a passage of scripture known as the Shema, which some Jews, even today, will have written in a box which they will wear on their foreheads as they pray. The first aspect of holiness is to love God fully with all our being, to love God fully with every part of us. And that means that we need to refocus our attitudes and choices, not to maintain a legalistic observance, but to live in such a way that asks the question, do my choices represent a full love for God? As I watch this movie, does that display a full love for God? As I perhaps put myself down or treat my body in a negative way, does that display love for God? God loves us deeply, and so our holiness is a response of love, not legalism. We will worship, we will pray, we will choose to read scripture, not because we have to or we're told it's the right thing to do, but because we love God fully with all our being. And then the second aspect of holiness in this passage is to love our neighbours as ourselves. Put simply, God's love is a gift, and if we have it, we need to give it away. Christianity should not be defined by what we don't do, but by what we will do. If I follow Christ, I will love my neighbour. It doesn't say I will refrain from treating my neighbour badly. It doesn't say I will keep my bad attitudes about my neighbour to myself. It says I will love them. Following Christ is about loving actions towards those around us rather than refraining from hurting others. Do we get that, what it's all about? What I will do, not what I won't do. We can't claim to be followers of Jesus if we aren't active in sharing God's love in a variety of ways, if we aren't active in mission. Our faith needs to be lived out and expressed as we love others. Action rather than abstinence. We need to understand our holiness in that type of way, sharing God's love around. You can't claim holiness if you're not active in sharing God's love in a variety of ways, active in making a difference in the world and the lives of others around us. Holiness is lived out and it's expressed as I love others. Holiness isn't achieved as we retreat from the world and protect ourselves in fear that others might make us stumble. But holiness is lived as we connect with society around us and express the love of God to all people. Not retreat, but action. Giving the love of God away. So is the glass half full or half empty? Do we have a negative perspective on faith, all about rules and prohibitions and the things that we won't do? Or do we have a fullness perspective on holiness? Is your Christian living defined by the richness of who you are and what you will pursue? What did Jesus say? Love God, love your neighbour. It's as simple and as complicated as that.
Take my life and let consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages. Silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose. myself, and I will be ever only all for thee. Take myself, and I will be ever only all for thee. Here am I.
We thank you that we have had the chance of encountering you as our Lord and Saviour. We thank you for the love and grace which you have showered upon us and for the difference that that makes in our hearts and lives. And Lord, we would pray that you might remind us to live lives of fullness, lives which are defined by all the things that we will do in your name rather than the things that we won't do. May our faith, may our holiness be marked by action rather than by abstinence. Lord, may we pursue full lives of love for you as our God and express that love for you as our God through a full love for our neighbour and for those around us in this world as well. Lord, remind us each day when we are tempted to perhaps see our faith as a half-empty thing, that actually our lives are full of you and your love for us, and that we can express that love in this world. Lord, may we live lives of active, passionate faith for you that makes a difference in us and through us for the sake of others. And now a benediction. Go now with courage in our God. Declare the message of the gospel which God has entrusted to us. And in wholehearted love for God and for others, share not only the message, but share your very selves. And may God be your haven. May Christ Jesus lead you into love, heart, soul, and mind, and may he gladden all of your days. We go in peace to love and serve our Lord. Amen and amen. God bless you.